will be live only in smartphones. We are live, Kripa.
So, good afternoon, everyone in India. Hopefully, if you're watching, good evening or good night, wherever you are. So, I'm Kripa, and my webinar for today is more of developing an unschooling mindset. So, before I start, I want to be very clear about some things. Like, first, this is not meant to be a debate between unschooling and traditional schooling, and I'm not here to claim that unschooling or homeschooling is the best way to go forward. I feel that it's up to each individual, each family, each child, and what resources you are working with, what situation you are in. And secondly, what I would like to say is that I am not the expert, complete repository of all things unschooling. I have been learning for the past 6 years and I'm still continuing to learn. Unschooling. One second. Divya J, can you please mute yourself? Okay. Okay, now I'm not the complete repository of knowledge. So I'm still learning. I still have a lot to learn. My son is only 6 years old. So I will share what I have learned and what aspirations I have and what I think even school children can do when they get unschooled. If you ask me if I have all the answers, I'm giving you the same answer that I give my son. I most definitely do not, but there's always a way to learn and move forward. So now that that's established, I'd like to go in. If you are on live or if you are in the Zoom, I ask you to please close your eyes for 2 minutes as I read out to you my favorite quote. That which does not cleanse our conscience, which does not teach us how to keep our minds and senses in control, that does not make us fearless and self-reliant, and that does not help us answer questions of sustenance, that does not make us courageous enough to deny slavery and seek freedom. Such an education, even if it's a treasure trove of information, even if it enables us to make effective arguments, and even if it provides us with scholastic command over language, cannot be called education. And even if it is, then it is an incomplete one. So this was said by Mahatma Gandhi, and this, out of many reasons, was also one of the reasons why I decided to unschool, homeschool Coven. Some of you might know that I'm a storyteller, so I'd like to begin with a small story. I know, it doesn't sound like a baby, but this was the cry of a baby. On the day the baby was born, he was carried to his mother and father, but soon after, whisked away. Whisked away to, of course, do what? They weighed him, they measured him, and they plotted him on a graph. So the doctor said, this is his height. Shortness probably runs in your family. That's why he's so short. This is his weight. 2.8 kilos. That's lesser than average. So they went back the next month. And this time the doctor said, ah, 2.5 kilos. What happened? What are you doing with him? The next month they went again. Ah, 3 kilos. Okay, much better, they said. Now, pretty soon the months went by and the child's first birthday came. The child by now was walking, and his mother, for the first time, took the child to a place that the child had never been before. She scooped him up in her arms and went outside to a far corner of their garden. And on that wall, a muddy, dirty wall, bugs and insects crawling, but on that wall were some dark engravings, some pencil markings. And so she scooped her child, made the child stand, and made a pencil mark against the child's head on the wall. Ah, Kanna, your height. And so that day, the child's name and the child's height was on that wall. This became a yearly ritual. So every year, the mother scooped the child up, went out, well, at least till she could scoop the child up, went to that far end of the garden and said, ah, Kanna, your height. And so year after year, the mother did this, from baby to toddler, from toddler to child, from child to preteen, and now teenager. And now mom could barely reach the head of the child to mark. The child turned 18. And on the 18th birthday, she led the child out. She needed a stool now. She stood up upon a stool and marked the height. She looked at that wall, a bit grungy now. The painters had decided to paint, but they left that section of the wall with those dark engravings. Now, over the years, the children had multiplied in the family. And the engravings were now all over the place. There were engravings of the mother. There were engravings of the father. Generations of engravings were on that wall. And the mother looked. She looked at the engravings, one by one. Ah, Kanna, how you have grown, she said. And remember, she looked at the engravings only of her child. Only of her child when the child was one. Only of that child when the child was a toddler. Only of that child when the child was a preteen, a teen, and now an adult. Now I want you to remember this story, and I want you to think about that. The mother didn't look at the other engravings of that child and how the child grew. The mother didn't look at other children or other, even her own engravings as the child grew. And this precisely is my philosophy for unschooling. And so we begin. I share the little knowledge that I've gained over the 6 years. So, who, why, and how? That little girl that you see over there in the red oversized sweater with those smiling parents, that's me. Yes, my parents were also smiling, but they were not just smiling parents. They were high achievers, overachievers, actually, in fact. And they came from a family of overachievers. My mother was an architect. She passed out of SAP, Anna University, and my dad, a civil engineer who passed out of IIT Madras. And if you think that was bad, everyone from my family was either an engineer, well, mostly engineers, and mostly software engineers to be precise. I came from a family that had academics at its forefront, and education was given utmost importance, which I think, if you are Indian, is probably true for every one of you out there. So, coming from this family, I was very lucky to have lived in different countries across the world. And that is thanks to my very illustrious father, who always takes a challenge, loves a challenge, and plunges into a challenge head first. He moved from India to Papua New Guinea, to Fiji, to Australia, to the US, and finally, he found his true calling in returning back to his home country, India. For most part, that's where I grew up, in India. Now that you know that, let's come to the point that I got married. So I got married to this wonderful man, Kovlin. Now, Kovlin is a go-getter and achiever himself. But what is remarkably different about this husband of mine is that he takes life as it comes. He is the calm in the storm and a very balanced person. The complete opposite of who I was. And the worst, or maybe perhaps best part of getting married to Kovlin was soon after we were married, and I don't mean 1 year soon, I mean 3 weeks into our marriage, we knew that I was pregnant. And I was like, what? No way. We're not doing this. We are incapable. We don't even know each other. But life happened. And so now I had a new marriage. I mean, my only marriage, but new husband. And we moved to Singapore, which is the country I reside in now. New country. And now I had to think about this child. And to be very honest, till my son was born, I was probably the worst possible mother ever. I did not want the child. I felt embarrassed to have this child. And I absolutely did not want to be a mom. I had dreams to pursue. I had places to see. But now, and this child ended up. And I was very upset as to not having that aha moment. The minute the child was placed, I merely said, oh, Narayya Mudi. And that was that. Now, the biggest gift for me was that I had no expectations, or I had no preparation, or I read nothing about how to be a mom. So from day one, Kavin, my son, was a plaything. He's over there. He's playful just like he was back then till today. I decided I would treat him as my friend, my doll, and just another human being. So I constantly spoke to Kavin, telling him about how I felt about life and the fact that he was there. And every day for the first 2 years of his life, I spoke to him like an adult. I would tell him what we were doing, what I was interested in, what my interests were, what we were looking at. Anything that I looked at, I spoke about. And I wasn't the parent who went out and researched. I didn't do any research as to, is this the right way to parent? Is he hitting his developmental milestones? No, I was registered to an app that, for me, that was merely to upload his photographs. But the app kept sending me these developmental milestones. He has done this or done that. He should be doing this, which thankfully I never really noticed. When he turned one, he wasn't walking. And that's when I noticed everyone around us talking about this developmental milestone that he had missed. But still, I was still the playful child. And luckily, I spent my time just roaming out to him. So an average day looked like this. I woke up and I hated to be at home because the house would turn into a mess. Even in Singapore, I hadn't figured out what to do. I wasn't going to work, at least I wasn't going to work as a software engineer, which was what I trained to study. I mean, that's what I studied and was trained to do. So I had all this free time and I didn't want to make a mess at home. So every day I packed my bag as my husband left for work, backpack on my back and water, food. Kavin was breastfeeding at the time, so nothing to pack for him. Yay! And so I left. Every day I would leave, go to the local library and sit and read and read and read to Kavin. in the children's section. I would read until he fell asleep. Now that he had conveniently fell asleep, I'd put him in the stroller and walk around the mall and probably have a coffee or do what I like to do, sit outside. And if he was still sleeping and I had time, I would go to the library and read books. So this went on and on. For the first 2 years of life, Kavin would have easily had 200 and something odd books just read to, nothing else. I was fortunately an avid reader, so that was something that I felt even early on that I would want Kavin to do. So he was read books in English and Tamil, and this went on. Now when he hit two years, as every Indian person would want it, I wanted to put him in school. Yeah, everyone told me to put him in school. I was like, yeah, let's go put him in school. So I took him, put him in school. And within 3 short months, I noticed something happen. I was always a lazy person, and I became even more lazier. Kavin's school was right in the middle of the day. So I couldn't leave to take him out to a library before he went to school. And after he came back from school, he usually fell asleep. And by then it would be too late for me to leave with a 2-year-old child to take him out anywhere. So in 3 short months, I realized something. Kavin was becoming dumber, if not for a better word. And I really didn't understand how this was possible. Of course, I knew that the number of books I was reading to him had come down. But later, in retrospect, I saw that the time that I got to communicate with Kavin went down drastically. And every day I would receive complaints from his teacher about something or the other. He was the youngest in his class, and it was a Montessori setup. So within that setup, he threw a pencil, and then we got complaints. And so for every single day, I would stand at the Montessori center until that breaking point came. And one day when I went to pick him up, that particular Montessori center had Kavin watching some cartoon video or something on the phone. And I was extremely mad. My house is right in the same block as this school. And I couldn't understand how it wouldn't take me much time to come from my house to the school. They gave me an excuse that they were just waiting. So with that, coupled with the fact that I wanted to leave to Singapore often, I said, okay, you know what? He's 2. It doesn't matter if he goes to school or not. And I just pulled him out. And it was then, that was the turning point for me to even explore and know more about homeschooling or unschooling or whatever. I was also very fortunate to be living in a country like Singapore, where education, traditional education, is extremely expensive. So that gave me even more motivation to find a way to school my child at home. This is a little bit about who I am, so you get where I'm coming from. Now, what is homeschooling? And what is that broad umbrella term called homeschooling, and what did I mean about that? There's so many terms out there. Initially, when I got into it, it was quite overwhelming. Homeschooling, unschooling, wild schooling, radical schooling, road schooling. So I'm just going to break down and quickly define what each method of schooling believes in. And from there, you can go and explore yourselves if you want. Now, homeschooling is generally considered, when said plainly, as the umbrella term for all kinds of learning methodologies that doesn't take place in a physical school. Now, what is traditional homeschooling? Traditional homeschooling is when you have a set curriculum, you get to choose your curriculum, and then you take written exams every year. And with that, traditional homeschooling families have a setup similar to school at home. They will have a dedicated study space. They will have educational toys, pencils, rubbers. You can imagine like a small preschool, if they are young children, a small preschool setup at home in one room. They will have assignments. They will have worksheets. They will have a lot of written work. That being said, traditional homeschoolers also just have a lot of time to go and explore outdoor activities and stuff to do in the environment, like community service, etc. Now, while schooling. While schooling is very rare in India, except for very few places in Rajasthan that I've heard. So basically, if a family is already living in the wild or close to the wild or on a farm or near a forest or in an extremely natural, nature accessible environment, then people prefer while schooling. Now, usually if you see wild schoolers, they don't just rely only on nature to wild school, but nature will be a very big part of the kind of learning that they do. They learn about the trees, they learn about the rivers, they learn about the birds, they learn about how to differentiate between poisonous snakes. So the focus is really a lot on nature and what you can learn from nature. Road schooling. Actually, this term was introduced to me by my close friend, Arpita, who is also a smart mommy. And she, when I was speaking to her a couple of years ago, she was telling me that based on what I was telling her I was doing with Coven, she said, well, oh, Kripa, you're road schooling. So road schooling is, in very simple terms, anything that you teach a child through travel or on the road is road schooling. Radical unschooling. There is a lot of fluff about radical unschooling. I personally don't know any radical unschoolers, and I doubt how many Indians will be interested in radical unschooling, because radical unschooling basically says that there are no rules. The children have no rules. They can wake up whenever they want. They can sleep whenever they want. They can study whenever they want. They can play how much ever they want, and you rely completely on the child's own interest, drive, and ethics of how much that they want to learn. Eclectic schooling. It's a fairly recent term that I've heard. Maybe it's been there longer. It's probably what I'm doing as well, which is basically a mishmash of all these different kinds of schooling. I have a little bit of homeschooling, a little bit of curriculum, a little bit of extracurricular activities, little bit of no curriculum, little bit of going into nature. And by a little bit of going to nature, I mean like forest schools or independent scouts and guides bodies where you can sign up to be a part of a club instead via school. And that's all over the world. And basically making up something that really works for your child in coming from a place where you are 100% convinced with yourself. That's eclectic schooling. Christian or religious homeschooling is where the focus is predominantly on teaching Christian values. They will have a lot of Bible study. They will have a lot of church-based community activities. They will have a lot of church-sponsored international activities like, you know, house building, stuff like that. They will have a lot more of Christian curriculum to cover. If they are Christian homeschoolers. And another fine example for religious homeschooling is in recent times, this young boy, Abhyangya, who has been predicting the COVID and everything, I would say that they are fairly doing what you would call religious homeschooling, because there is a big component of religion and spiritual values that is part of what he is learning. Now, world schooling. World schooling is when you just pack up and leave. The world is your, well, the world is your school. You leave, you travel from place to place, you learn about the culture. There are world schooling communities all over the world. So basically they are like small settlements across the world where you can go, stay with other fellow world schooling families, learn amongst them, and travel from place to place. So this is not very practical for everyone. So I've noticed that some homeschoolers and some unschoolers choose to go for a trip to such world schooling community setups and spend like maybe a month or 2 months in those places, which are usually very affordable, very basic, and everyone who comes has to contribute towards the community setup of that place. Now, self-directed learning. Self-directed learning is the current buzz term that I've seen in the past year. To me, this is what everyone has to strive and achieve for in life. Every person, every human being is hardwired to learn, especially children. And when that learning comes from one's own interest, that is self-directed learning. So I truly believe that self-directed learning isn't particular to children or particular to adults, not particular to homeschoolers, not particular to children that are in school. It is basically, I want to learn this, so I'm here. Like, that's self-directed learning. Okay, so fine. All this is fine. What exactly do you mean by child-led learning? What exactly do you mean by that? I want you, because everyone is from Smart Mommies, I'm assuming that all of you are mommies and you all have children. So I want you to imagine, just before we started this call, Megha Bharati, who's on the Zoom, was saying that the kinds of things that she was observing, the developmental milestones of her child as part of unschooling. And that is living proof of how a child is naturally curiosity driven and wants to learn. So a baby is usually lying on the floor. Yeah, but who tells the baby that now it's time to turn? You have to turn. Okay, maybe there are some overzealous parents who want to meet those developmental milestones. So they're placing toys and objects next to the baby to see if the baby will reach out, to see if the baby will try. So let's forget about those parents for a moment and think about parents that don't really mind or don't really have the time to mind. Those children end up turning themselves. So how does that happen? How do you go from a child that was lying on its back to a child that is now crawling, right? And how does that child go from crawling to walking? If you have noticed children trying to keep their first steps, the drive is always from inside and they never, ever give up. They fall, they get up. They fall, they get up. So why? You know, who gives them the motivation? Why do they want to learn that? What is it that makes it so attractive to them to learn? Now, this is what in my mind unschooling looks like. And it's not like that. Like, children sometimes are teased or degraded when parents say, "Dalla matto nalla kattuko, dalla matto." So how do you think that child's, let's say they're learning some movie song out of their own and they're able to recite dialogues from the movie. So how did that learning happen? It is a kind of learning. It is a kind of memorization. It is a kind of deep drive to learn and curiosity learn. So the fact that you are saying idella matta eppadi kattikitena idella and koyana interested ah irukku adha and koyana thana kattikichu is the answer to this question, and it is the fundamental basis of unschooling in what I believe. Okay, so let's be clear what not is unschooling, or maybe could be traditional homeschooling. So school at home, right? So just replicating whatever the teachers do at home is not unschooling at all, especially the preconception, misconception that homeschooling means the child will never leave the four boundaries of four walls of the home is the biggest misconception. 2 weeks ago, one of my friends who lives in the UK said, "Wow, Kripa, how do you do it? You know, now I know the real challenge that you face with homeschooling during these COVID times." That really broke my heart, because honestly, what you're seeing now during COVID is not how homeschooling looks at in at all. In fact, most homeschooling kids are suffering by this lockdown. I would say that like 70% of the time, homeschooling or unschooling kids spend their time outside the house in some community collaborative space. So to call this situation as homeschooling was probably the biggest prompt that I got to do this webinar in the first place, and kind of do away with the illusions of what it is not. Now, parent or teacher-led education, and I'm saying this specifically to unschooling. If you are traditionally homeschooling, you will still use a curriculum or you'll still use a teacher. But when it comes to parent-led, what I mean is the child can still use an instructor to learn. For example, if the child wants to learn about rockets, right? The question comes from the child and not the parent. The parent doesn't go and say, okay, today we're going to learn about rockets. Or today we're going to, the child comes with a question and the parent is merely a facilitator that takes that question, finds all the available resources that one can afford or one can bear. If you know the answer to the question yourself, the parent answers. If not, the parent finds a resource. If the resource is not enough to quench the thirst of that child, then the parent takes it from there and finds a subject matter expert to facilitate the whole process. Basically, the parent is a facilitator. Now, a simple example, which I already spoke about, is think about why you are here today. Why are you watching this video and what motivated you to come? In a sense, you are unschoolers yourself because you chose to come here. You chose to listen to me go on and on. So that is what unschooling is all about. Okay, Kripa, illa idella nalla da irukke kekkuradhukku real life examples solli enna da nee panna indha 6 varshathula. So I'm going to quickly cover a few things of what it looks like. We were walking the other day down this place, and we were on our way to our social service. So every week since Kavin turned 4 years old, me and Kavin have been volunteering at a senior center. And prior to volunteering at a senior center, we were assigned a senior, right? So the job of this volunteer is to go to the seniors and talk to them every week for an hour and ask them how they're doing, check up on their health, see if anything is wrong. So this is part of my unschooling curriculum for Kavin. And at 4 years old, we were walking down, and at his height, this bush was at his height. So obviously I didn't spot it, but he said, "Amma, look, caterpillar." And so the more we observed in that place, we ended up finding a cocoon. We ended up finding a baby caterpillar. We ended up finding a big fat caterpillar that you would see in Hungry Caterpillar with its stomach full. Now, I could have achieved the same lesson objective by reading the Hungry Caterpillar book. But instead, he went out, he found this for himself. And after post-activity of this happening, I went back, went to the library, got the Hungry Caterpillar book, read about it. Then we got an actual science-y, textbooky life cycle of a caterpillar, and then we read about it. So that is how the parent could supplement, that is how the parent could facilitate that learning. Now, when he was 3 years old, when I was singing some devotional song about Muruga, adhula vandha Navaratnam appdin vandhuchu. So this fellow who was listening said, "Navaratnama, Navaratnamna enna? Enna comedy na enake Navaratnamna ennu theriyadhu. Andha 9 ratnam ennu enake theriyadhu." Then I was like, "Tellie, let's go to the library." And so from there, we went to the library. And you won't believe, there wasn't a single book in the children's section that spoke about gemstones. So we decided to go to the adult section. And I found this huge, thick adult book that looked like a dictionary. And said, "You know, Kavin, do you want to read this?" And then he's like, yes, read it for me. So obviously I can't read everything from that adult textbook, but I found a way to simplify it so that he learned about the gemstones. And so by the end of that month, he was reciting the 9 gemstones, telling me the properties of those gemstones. He was aware of smelting. He was aware of mining. He was aware of ores. And this was at 3 years. Now, what is fascinating is 2 years later, in a completely different conversation, Kavin was able to refer to some other scenario as ore. And he spoke about mining. You know, you have to really mine if you want to get it, or something like that. So seemingly I don't have a test that Kavin took to prove that he learned gemstones, but it eventually showed up 2 years down the line. Learning Tamil using addition. This is my favorite. So Kavin, for some reason, loves math. Yeah, and till this lockdown, the beginning of January, he did not want to learn Tamil at all. And I come from a family where people write Tamil poems, people love to speak in Tamil. So for me, Tamil is a big component of what I want in his life. And I tried desperately and miserably many times to introduce to him. Coupled to the fact that we live outside of India, it's really tough to get in. If you are in the US, you know what I'm talking about. And sometimes even if you live in Chennai, you know what I'm talking about, because I saw my cousin struggling miserably to learn Tamil despite studying in India. So I figured out his hook. So he loved math. So I decided I was going to say, you know, Kavin, ikka plus a pota, can you imagine that when you add those two, the answer is ka, Kavin. So basically, in essence, what you're doing is addition. You're not learning letters, you know, you're learning addition. And that was his hook. So Kavin went from not knowing a single Tamil letter in January, and within 1.5 months, he had learned all 247 letters that he wanted to write. And the following month, like now, he's able to write small sentences on his own with spelling mistakes, but he is able to write and read. And that's all that I wanted. So how did this happen that for the first five and a half years of his life, he did not want to learn at all? And what jump-started this thing? What jump-started it? I used every hook I could find, every trick I knew, because I knew he loved addition. I knew he loved the Bahubali. That the song where he picks up the lingam and puts it. I knew that he loved that. He was fascinated by that song. And I kept telling him, well, you're fascinated by it, but you're not even able to sing it, right? So don't you want to learn? I mean, you love it so much and then you're not learning it. That really resonated with him because he got the why of what he wanted to do. So he learned the whole song. And now he's halfway through writing the whole piece. So these are things that you can do. Find your child's hook. Find what interests your child and then use it to your advantage. Now, what does an unschooling environment look like? Does it look like school? Well, no, right? Even some homeschoolers don't have their homes looking like school. So to me, homeschooling or unschooling is about learning how to do your chores, learning how to take responsibilities, learning how to, like Megha Bharati said earlier, learning how to greet somebody when they come home. What is the first thing that you do? You know, do you give them a glass of water? And if there are elders around to teach, well, you're lucky. Well, if they are not, then parents consciously tell these things. It's learning from going to a stranger independently and asking for help. You know, the parents can be in the background, but going and being able to ask by a 3 or 4 year old or 6 year old or even 10 years old by looking at nature and being curious about it and not feeling ashamed to be curious. Now, if you're in the audience, I would like to do something right now. Now imagine you are at your most creative age, or most enthusiastic age, I should say. Imagine you are 5 years old or four, and the teacher has asked a question in school. Yeah. And I want you to imagine yourself as the most eager person in that room, the most enthusiastic mundri kotta. And I want you to raise your hand the way you would imagine that mundri kotta raising your hand. Pick me, pick me, pick me, pick me. Hopefully you've done it. I can't see any of you, but I'm hoping that you tried this exercise out. And I want you to feel how you felt. How did that feel? How did it feel to put your hand up there and stretch and say, what I've noticed is as the years go by, that hand goes from here to here to here to here until it's this. It's that bored student looking at the most enthusiastic teacher sitting in front of them, but they're like, Or sometimes they give you the zombie stare. So where did that curiosity go? And how come once we are out there in real life, when we actually become an adult, we are forced to learn skills, we are forced to communicate, we are forced to upgrade ourselves. So what did we lose out? Where did that curiosity go? That providing every opportunity for the child to ask questions and have them be answered is what an unschooling environment looks like. It doesn't have to be fancy. You don't have to live in the richest country in the world. No, it has to be a safe space where children are allowed to explore, question, and ask themselves questions. And I'm pretty sure there's a question about, okay, this is fine for young children. What do I do with older children? And I'll come to that later. Okay. Now, these are some assumptions that when you do with your own child, forget about whether the child is unschooled. Even if the child is schooled, you say that, okay, let him go to a class. And you doubt whether your child will be able to do it. Swimming kathikkanunga seri. So the tata or party will be saying, pa appdi kenathla thooki poduma appdi kathupanga. Now I'm not advocating that is the best method. Out of practice I realize that is the worst method to teach swimming, but you never gave the child to go and learn in the child's own way. And you decided that 5 years la da swimming class seithupanga appo na 5 years la da swimming kathikkanum. But that's not true. It has nothing to do with age. It merely has to do with the skill of the child, the ability of the child, and how much interest the child has. So the school unfortunately forces us to constrict ourselves into saying that this is the right thing that has to be done at this age. It can go both ways. Either your child might be excelling in one particular thing, subject, and in another subject, your child might be far behind. So the whole concept of saying this is age appropriate or this is when I'm going to teach my child. If the child is going to school, then in the time that the child doesn't go to school, does the child have resources to try? That is what I mean. Now, socialization. Now, the biggest misconception, which I hate addressing and I'm tired of explaining, is socialization. How social can my kid be? I'm not denying the fact that there are introverts in the world and there are extroverts, right? And introverts who go through school will also, even as adults, tend or lean toward being introvert. Even if they open up and bloom up, they will tend to be being an introvert. And extroverts, no matter where you put them, will be extroverts. Now, homeschooling children don't stay at home. They go out to playgrounds. We have something called community or co-ops, community operatives. But homeschooling parents get together weekly, monthly, bi-weekly, and they meet sometimes for a particular discussion or subject like science or math or art and literature, but they also meet for festivals. They also meet for, to discuss, like for example, we had a co-op where they discussed ASEAN countries. So every child had to read about an ASEAN country, and they had we had like a 12-week period, and every child would present at the end of that period. And then we have a social co-op called Park Hoppers, where they visit parks across the country. Now, I'm fortunate to be in Singapore, so there's already a very well-established network of homeschooling communities here. But I know for a fact that Chennai has a homeschooling community. I know that Bangalore has a very vibrant homeschooling community. And I know Mumbai has a homeschooling community as well. So what is most important? And the fact that your child can walk out on the road and Go buy a bag of groceries and come back and make the grocer their friend. Make the local security guard their friend. You can observe, you can supervise, of course, but to make the child to be able to speak to anyone outside their age bracket is what socialization is all about. Because in the real world, there is no scenario where you're going to be working with or collaborating with or speaking with only children or people from your own age, right? So socialization in essence means being able to speak or communicate effectively with all kinds of people from all different backgrounds and all different ages. So if you ask me if homeschoolers and unschoolers are social, they are some of the most social children that I've ever met, because they have the time and the opportunities to go out and explore. We've already spoken about self-directed learning and the fact, but the one misconception is that children are lazy and we need to instruct them. We need to tell them, we are the parents, and if we don't, they will become lazy. That unless you try this out, you will not know. Like even on weekends, if you are able to speak to your child to set a goal plan or a plan for themselves that they want to execute for the things that they love, you will see the difference yourself. And honestly, it cannot be explained, and no amount of examples that I give will convince you if you believe that. Like I spoke before, home is not where the learning happens always. We discuss more. Okay, so all this, how can you implement something like this at your home, especially now that you're in lockdown? You have the luxury of trying these out if you have time. If you don't have time, maybe on the weekends when you don't have work, you can try it out. 1 week of no agenda. Like I will have no agenda. I'll have no expectations for my child. I'll have no worksheet completion, nothing. Just 1 day and even 1 week. And even if they daydream the whole day, your responsibility as the parent should be at the end of the day or at the beginning of the day or whenever the child is open up to talk, is ask, what were you thinking about? What were you dreaming about? And the kind of answers that you will get, one, will give you a hook into how they can be explored. And two, will let you understand the psyche of your child. Today I asked my son, I'm doing this homeschooling webinar. So what do you think? What is that you hate about homeschooling? You know, what should be improved? What do you think that Amma is very hopeless at? And what should I address? And he came up with an answer that stunned me. He said, sometimes you force your passions on me and you don't give my passions enough time and space. And then I was like, well, I thought you liked to do this. And he said, yes, of course I do. But you don't show the same enthusiasm in my passions as you do in yours. So either you give me more time to explore my passions, or you stop thrusting down your passions down my throat. And to me, that was stunning, coming from a six-year-old, that he was able to put this into words. And where he came from gave me a completely new perspective. So you will get an insight only if you give them time to stop and think. Okay, so the next thing is the question blackboard. I use this a lot because obviously children come up with a lot of questions, and at most times we're not able to answer every single question then and there on the spot. And not just that, maybe we just don't know the answer. So we have this blackboard. Every time a question comes up and I'm not able to answer it right then, the question goes on the blackboard. So by the end of the week or whenever you choose to remove those questions from the blackboard, you can hit them one by one and explain to your child. Now, open-ended activities. Open-ended activities can be any chore, I would say, is an open-ended activity where you have no predefined or adult-defined goal at the end. You have to fight the urge to have an adult-defined goal. Like, for example, there are many children activities nowadays, right? To do, maybe there are two cups and then you have to take it from one cup to another. Or for older children, they have book reports. So they read a book and then they have to identify the character. They have to identify the protagonist and then they have to write a small report about it. Or for even older kids, they have a project where they have to do a lot of research and then present it. Now, unfortunately, many parents, including me, rush to help your children. You rush to, if this is how a project should be presented, you say them, you tell them, oh, this is how it should be done. Oh, you should use this kind of font, or you can use this kind of graphic, or you should take the object from this cup and put it into the other cup in this particular way. And if the child just decides to do something different, you're like, ah, oh, I'm not able to do anything with you. You don't understand. You take it personally. But if you just let them be, you can always explain to them what your objective is. But if you really notice, especially in children, younger children that haven't been conditioned yet by life as to this is the way to approach life, or this is the way to do things. If you notice those children, you will see them doing something differently. And if you pause to ask them why they did that, you'll get remarkable answers. I've seen this, but unless you experience it, you will not be convinced. Now, making available local content. So I say this from, even if you're in India, there is a, unfortunately, because of all the colonialization and the exposure that Western countries get, a lot of the books that children nowadays read are very Western books. Or at least I grew up reading, even in India, Harry Potter, Snow White, Cinderella, and even the rhymes that I learned were Incy Wincy Spider, Hot Cross Buns, with no relevance. How I didn't even know what a hot cross bun was until I was 25 years old. So all this content that they're consuming leaves no space for you to talk about your heritage. So if your child is school going, what should you be doing on your weekends? Instilling a love or pride for your nation, your country, your heritage. Can you visit a local temple? So how many children, or even how many of us, know what the history of our local temple is? When it was built, you know, who paid for it, or who renovated it, or, you know, where did it come from? Just till my father, after he became a grandfather, took my son out to the most prominent locations in Chennai, like Santhom Church or Marina Beach or even the museum or the library, I did not know personally that Chennai had so much to offer. I was stuck, of course. I was in the malls when I was in college. I went all to the school assigned field trips, but I really didn't know what resources we had ourselves. So how many people take time to go and explore? These are things that you consider and explore. And when I mean local content, I mean local folk tales, local folk music, you know, going back to your village and seeing what does your village produce, or what does India make? What does your state make? What is your state famous for? Really learning, not learning for the sake of making a presentation. I mean, learning because either you love it and the child starts appreciating it, you want to appreciate it, something like that. So making available local content is what I meant by that. And then a focus on the hook, we've spoken a lot about it. Strewing is the most loved and favorite way for all unschoolers across the globe. So strewing is basically when you, despite how laid back you want to be, despite how away from not pushing the child you want to be and being a pushover, adults do want their children to ask certain questions, or they do want to see some learning outcomes, right? They do want them to learn. Instead of staying in a small bubble of whatever that is, whether that curriculum is a small bubble or whether that the person and the place that they're living is a small bubble, you still want to see children ask questions, and you want the questions to come from them. That's when you use strewing. So you take either you take objects or you take books or you take something that might trigger a conversation, and then you lay it out somewhere in the realm of the child. Somewhere that you know that obviously this will lead to a question. And that is when you get your hook. So I love strewing because I'm a big manipulator. I do come from an overachieving family like many of you, which means I have certain goals in the back of my mind. And even if those goals don't get achieved, I believe that as a parent, I have to do my part to make sure that these questions are being asked. So that's that. And homeschoolers get the advantage of being at family functions, being at family weddings, being at home for religious functions. And India being like a cultural hub for all these things, many of our children miss out. And I think it's important to use that time to learn why this religious function was there. What are the elements of a marriage? You know, why do they do this? All these things I see as windows of opportunities where you can interact with your child, you can talk more about it. And they are important. It's history. Basically, it's history, and you're teaching history. And this will work even more for school-going children where, you know, when you go and you end up and you don't even think about all this when you're sitting there, but then there is just so much knowledge to share. And when you go there, you meet elders and relatives and get everyone to pitch in and talk to your child. Volunteering. This is my personal belief that every child will learn the value of being a human being on this earth only when they volunteer. If you are, like for example, I live in Singapore, and Singapore is a very rich country. Right? They have almost all the resources in the world, but there is still this unseen population that really struggle for their basic necessities. But you never see that when you see Singapore as a whole. So for me, just the awareness that, you know, people like this exist, this is how they live, and what little can you do to bring some joy in their world is very important for me. It's always been. I have never waited to get my parents' permission to volunteer anywhere. I've always been volunteering since I was a child. And then during college, I volunteered every week to go and teach school children. So for me, volunteering is a big part to inculcate. Now, the art of asking for help. Yes. Many of us high achievers fail to do, especially many Indians living in nuclear setups or abroad do not ask for help in the community. And by community, I don't mean getting together, Sunday, va, biryani sapla, ellaro vanga, and sitting and gossip. No, I don't mean that. I mean your 3 a.m. call. You know, you call at 3 a.m., whether it's your parent, whether it's your grandparent, whether it's your uncle or aunt, you know that when you call, they will be there for you. Yeah, Kripa, so how does that matter when I'm unschooling or educating or schooling my child? You know, how does that matter? Yeah, or emergency, na varada seivanga. But it's much more than that. It's, you have to see the value in the relationships that you built, whether it's familial relationships or friends, and always seek out ways in which that person can educate your child. Is there someone in your circle that is aeronautical engineer? Is there somebody in your circle that is accomplished in some particular field that you want your child to know about? Or is there just one day that, you know, you can't do this anymore and I need someone to babysit your child? And most times, it's not that the people in your circle don't want to help you. I find that people are too shy to ask for help. I rely heavily on everyone around me to do what I'm doing today. And I say this with a lot of emotion because Smart Mommies gave me the platform to kind of get out of that rut that, you know, I'm a mom now. My life is ended. This is how I was. So dramatic. And Smart Mommies opened me up in a way that nothing else could have. Okay, so there is more to life. And after coming to Singapore, I'm a part of Singapore Smart Mommies. Such an encouraging community. Big shout out to all of you. There is always help given when asked. I know that I can ask for help to school my child, to take care of my child, to just talk to my child, to have a collaborative event, to ask your parents. I rely heavily on all these relationships that I've cultivated. I rely on my neighbor. I bribe my neighbor with food so that one day when I need someone to take care of Coven, then there will be someone. I have no shame in saying that. I heavily rely on my father, who has been instrumental in creating an unschooling environment for Coven. So grandparents can do so much for your child. My father is an exceptionally great grandparent. They go on hiking trips for a month alone, just grandfather and grandson. They go together, they explore, they travel around India, they travel abroad, they have word games. Now that we are in COVID, they are doing word games. And I have a feeling that I kindled this out of my father and said, my father offering. So you have to really find communities that will build you up. There will always be a bunch of enthusiastic homeschooling parents around you. If only you seek and search, you will find. And you can get together, you can discuss curriculum. And even with your schooled parents, you can always ask for help. Because if you choose to do homeschooling, if you choose to do unschooling, it is an enormous burden. With that enormous burden, you really must ask for help. Anyway, so you as a parent, I've spoken a lot about this. So I'm just going to go ahead and skip to be available, adaptable, humble, and trusting your child. Now, this slide was asked by my father to be included as, you know, not stop painting a glow goldy perfect picture about homeschooling. Tell us what the challenges are. Yes, so balancing all the family members' needs, what we have to do. Right now I have only one child, so it makes my life easy. So what happens when I have two children? My life's mantra is take it one year at a time as far as Coven's education is concerned. If I want to decide I will put Coven in school in next year, well, fine, so be it. I might have to do that, but then I have the flexibility to choose and not choose and keep the unschooling spirit at heart. So money, of course. So now we have only one stream of revenue for this family. So we do make cuts. We do have a lot of lifestyle changes and alterations, which is what we are willing to do to give this kind of an environment. It is tough. Not everyone can do it. As I mentioned before, I am painfully aware of my luxury. Even with that one salary, I'm able to run this family. Some simple things that I do is I do not... Just a second. Okay, sorry about that. So I've changed a lot of way I do. We don't buy any new clothes or new books for Coven. We get everything secondhand. We've changed our lifestyle to a more minimalist lifestyle. We spend a lot of money on experiences. We have changed our life goals and might not look like your life goals, but we are okay with that. And then comes the pressure. Even today, the pressure of sitting before you and speaking about homeschooling. And I know that it will bring a boatload of questions and the floodgates will open and everyone around us, generally when someone does something different or out of the ordinary, there will be a lot of pushback from everyone. So that pressure has always been there. And I honestly haven't found any way to stop that. A commitment of showing up, waking up, suiting up, and showing up for your child every single day is a true commitment. It takes a lot, but it's completely worth it. Building a community. If you live in a very isolated place, I would say it's better not to choose homeschooling or unschooling, because you really need the community to play a part. It takes a village to raise a child, and that's extremely true. Now, the uniqueness of being you, and the uniqueness sometimes makes you lonely, because all your friends might have children that are being schooled, and you will have your own little homeschooling community, but you will be lost sometimes when people around you don't seem to understand or don't seem to agree, or you are not able to relate to this. And so that's pretty much the challenges, but I feel that the benefits outweigh the challenges, at least till now, at least at this point in my life. I'm not arrogant enough to think that this is the best way forward. You have to constantly evaluate year after year, constantly decide what you want to do. I put in this slide just to appease Indians who might want shining examples. I really don't want to talk about them. I think I know far too less to talk about shining examples. And there's a far lot more that I have to learn. And the education is constantly evolving. CBSE and NCERT have brought in a lot of new policies into education. Whether they're being implemented completely, I'm unable to say, because it depends on your school. But I know that like 16 years down the line, education is going to look completely different. And measures of success for me are very different from other people. But still, because of popular demand, I wanted to include this. Now, about the exams, the most serious part, right? Before we get into question and answers. CBSE, if you're doing a CBSE or ICSE syllabus, you cannot take exams privately. So that is ruled out in India. If you, however, choose to do a state board or NIOS, National Institute of Open Schooling, Indian exam, then what it essentially means is till 10th grade, you can be free and not worry about any examinations, but you will have to take the 11th grade and 12th grade state board examinations. And using those marks, you can apply for college across India. Now, if you are studying the IGCSE at home as a curriculum, it's valid, except at public government institutions, government universities will not take the IGCSE examination board. And if you are an NRI, and because I see a lot of NRIs, I mean, not NRIs, if you are an OCI card holder, that is, the child is an OCI card holder, the child does not have an Indian citizenship, but you've returned back to India, then you get to take SAT, at least as of now. I don't know, the policies keep changing, so you have to look out for it. But you can take the SAT and you can get admission into college. So my brother did that. My brother and my sister, they did finish their 12th grade, but it was their SAT score that got them into college. Then we have Olympiad exams and SAT. So if you're applying for a university abroad, which in this context, I'm only going to say USA, then the universities ask for portfolios and SAT marks. But if you're in Australia does not require you to take the 12th grade examination at all. In fact, Australia just requires application to the university and portfolio submission, and you can get into university there as well. So now that all that is done, I think I get to see the chat now and answer questions. I am not fighting to prove that I am the one. In all honesty, I feel that unschooling can the unschooling mentality or that mindset, can the curious mindset must be fostered in every child. When I was in fifth grade and then there was a fancy dress competition, I had no one to help me. So I made the costume all by myself by stringing together leaves. And I put up a costume and I stood in front of everyone and I gave a speech about that I had written that I was a tree. But the competition that I got from others was all these lovely stitched costume from a store, and I couldn't compete with that. But I felt that it defeated the whole purpose of the talent show, that the child should be able to prove their own talents instead of the parents stepping in and proving the talent for them. So is stay at home mommy a prerequisite for homeschooling? So I would say yes, it's almost a full-time job. The compulsory part of that depends upon the country in which you're residing. Like, so if you're residing in Singapore and you're a Singaporean, then one parent is required to stay at home and they can work from home. Like in my case, I'm actually a storyteller. So I have found creative ways to work from home and even do events outside, but I schedule it around my son's schedule. So I am working and I'm doing this as well. But it's, you said you're doing a mix match of a few unschooling types. May I know what they are and how minimalism is supporting you in unschooling stuff? Okay, so what I meant by mixing types is, though I am unschooling, I know that I am not the expert of every field and I absolutely hate mathematics. So early on, when I was trying to teach Kavin swimming, I made the blatant mistake of throwing him in the water. At that point, Kavin told me, get me a teacher and I'll learn. So till he learned to swim, we had appointed a teacher. So I took that cue and for math and English, and previously for Tamil, Kavin used to go for classes, which were just like once or twice a week. And of course, there'd be work to do throughout the week. But essentially, he would spend time outside the classes, maybe 2 hours a week. And I have signed up for forest school where Kavin will go into the forest and they learn about nature. So I do a little bit of wild schooling. Apart from that, a little bit of religious schooling is basically kind of building up the curriculum based on what Kavin likes and what not he likes. So what he does for outside classes are, he goes to soccer class, he goes to this bhakti, which is a religious class at our local temple. He volunteers for 3 hours every week. He does a little bit of math, he does a little bit of English. He takes a lot of classes from outschool.com, which is a website where you can take independent classes like Udemy. And then he also takes a Tamil dramatics class separately. Apart from going to co-ops, homeschooling co-ops like Science Explorers where the homeschoolers get together, apart from going to dinosaur co-ops where all the dinosaur enthusiasts get together. So from, hi Kripa, Sudha from Smart Mommies. Nice to know about homeschooling, thank you. So next year, what is your plan for Kavin? So how long do you plan to homeschool your son? It's a good question for which my answer always is, I don't know, because we are very clear that we're going to take it 1 year at a time and go forward from there. I've already researched that, you know, whether my son will be able to join into a mainstream school at any point in life if he wants to. Like, for example, I get the coronavirus and I die. So what happens next? So I always take it upon myself to make sure that in some way he is equipped to switch to mainstream, and it is possible, at least in the potential countries which I am thinking of living, it is definitely possible, which is India and Singapore. And we do it every year, we do that evaluation every year. So as an experiment, We have signed up for the local government school here in Singapore next year because we want Kavin to make the decision for himself from his point of view instead of me saying that, you know, homeschooling, unschooling is the best way to do. So that is my definition of it. And maybe for him, that might not be true. He might like school better and he might thrive there better. So we have signed up. But we've decided that if he does get the government school in Singapore, we will send him. If he is rejected, then we will continue to homeschool. That's our solution as of now. Okay. Kripa, this is Karpagam. Do you also refer to the local school syllabus or any other stream syllabus to ensure that he is in par with academics? So for this, what I do is I take some online curriculum-based websites where they have a structure in place. And usually such websites, like for example, readingx.com, they have like an assessment test to assess at which stage or level according to their curriculum your child is. So periodically, just to know where my child is in, if he were to be placed in the real world, I mean, the schooled world, just to know where he would be, I do take these tests. And as I mentioned, in some subjects, he is far ahead, and in some subjects, he's a little backwards. Will he be writing exams every year? So I am not, like I told you, I have planned only for 1 year ahead. So for first grade, no, I don't believe in any examinations till a child turns 7 years old. Like it should be a choice for the child. After that, I will reevaluate my strategy. I constantly reevaluate my strategy. I constantly research and I try to mimic real life as much as possible. Wonderful to know. Thanks. Yes, thank you. Thank you, Megha Bharati. So Sangeeta, yes, Sangeeta mentioned, I also made a handout because I knew that what I have done is just give you a dipped into the water of what homeschooling is. I've made a handout that links to a lot of unschooling resources, homeschooling resources, places that you can read more about this. And I will share it on the Smart Mommies group as well, maybe directly on the Facebook page so that more people have access to it. It's basically a compilation of the websites that I use. It's a compilation of other homeschooling, unschooling blogs that I look up to. And it is also a composition of some frequently asked questions which I compiled earlier to this session. I've done homeschooling for my elder one since he happens to be a special child. And I approached it with my second child as well. Yay! Yes, I'm so glad, Devaki. I'm so glad. Hi, Kripa, Divya from Chennai. I'm homeschooling my six-year-old. Later, if he feels to go to school, how easily do the schools accept? Okay, so schools, there hasn't been a lot of homeschool kids, but what I'm hearing is that as long as you're able to take their test, right, they're able to take the school's entry test, and if they clear that, then you will be placed. And I'm also an example for that because when I came back from the US in fourth grade, this was in 1996, there were no children returning from the US to fourth grade. But when we approached the school, they actually didn't, at that point in time, they didn't even have a assessment test. They basically had an interview. And once they were convinced with the interview, they put me in the equivalent or... in fact, even a little more advanced in fourth grade here in India. So I'm assuming they will use the same route as children who return back from the US and want to join here. But you do not require by the law to have completed or have a completed certificate of anything. I think it's a good idea to start building a portfolio for your child, kind of documenting all the milestones that the child has met for that year. So what I do is every year, what I do is at the beginning of the year, I will write down what Kavin has achieved in the past year and what our goals are for the next year. So in the beginning of 2020, none of the goals that I wanted worked out because of COVID. We haven't even started on any of the goals. But having this kind of documentation will definitely help you if you want to get into a school later on. And even for you to see how far your child has come and have like a record. How you equip yourself to keep up the pace and give the knowledge that he needs. So I've noticed that in some places, Kavin is ahead of the curve, right? So I try to assess this with all these tests that I mentioned earlier. And research. I do a lot of research. I try to read all the unschooling blogs that are there, homeschooling blogs. I get books from students current Kavin's age and older to Kavin by 1 year's age, just to have a look and feel of, you know, what kids are doing in school. I will not necessarily implement that, but I kind of to understand what people are doing, and so that I'm also not in that small homeschooling bubble and think that I'm so great. What do you think are the basic areas of development the child has to be exposed to other than math and language? Okay, so definitely the child has to have a community to go and talk to. Secondly, the child, practical things that we do is doing the chores, having a responsibility, taking responsibility for that. Like, for example, it is Kavin's responsibility in this household to recycle our every weekly recycling things. He has to go down to the recycle bin and throw it. And he has to turn the washing machine on, and when the clothes are done, he will do it. So that creating responsibility. And then involving in a lot of speaking related activities where he gets an opportunity to actually go out and speak. And the third thing I would say is teaching him how to learn or how to research or where can he find knowledge. By teaching your child where this can be done, or you know, whether they should be going to the library, how do you research the library? How do you look at papers written? How do you speak to them about design thinking? So signing up for these webinars where the children are exposed to design thinking. I recently mentioned it. Avanti Natarajan from Smart Mommies, she had this course about design learning for children organized with another person. And they spoke about teaching children to think in design. So I feel that by providing all these resources and telling them that there are ways to get them and speaking adult conversations with your children, you will get a lot of questions. Like last week, I got a question about what collateral damage was. And so in process of explaining that, we got into world wars, World War I, World War II. So use the cues to explain whatever you want. There is no limit. There is no end limit. The limit is when your child gets bored. Until that, you speak about everything and anything. So whether it's cooking, whether it's speaking, why I concentrate on language and math is because math helps you calculate, and out there in the real world, you really do need to calculate. Why I focus on language is because unless you have a language, you cannot communicate, you cannot read. And the minute you learn to read, it opens up a whole new world. It opens up a huge world. So it's important to learn how to read. My whole basis for focusing on language is so that it will give further opportunities, or it will help you, equip you to go ahead. Do you feel he misses something without going to school? I asked him this question today, Naga. Actually, this is the question that I asked him, whether he misses school or not, or whether he misses. So he has a big gang of friends. So I think that is it. And the reason why I wanted him to try out school for a year was precisely this. I wanted him to make an informed choice about whether or not he liked school or whether he missed school. So say, right now he is in the position of not even being able to answer this question because he doesn't even know what school is. So my major motivation for making him experience at least 1 year of school is for him to understand what school is and have an opinion of his own instead of mine. Do you plan each day what to teach him? Also, if it's not mandatory to take each exam each year, then how do the promotions to each class take place? Okay, so every government has this. I'm at least I know the two governments, both the Singapore government and the Indian government, ask you to take a placement assessment kind of test. And usually this is very, in India, it's very school specific. In Singapore, it is centralized where you can take an examination and it gives you a level to which you will be assigned to, whether it's third grade or fourth grade or whatever. Now, do I plan? To an extent, I plan, but I keep his day mostly free. Only 2 hours of his day is planned every day. We have this game. So it's called Take the Random Bus. So we travel a lot by bus and walk. So we will go to the bus stop, take any random bus, the first bus that comes to the bus stop station or the first bus that Kavin wants to get into. And once we get into, we will just keep going until Kavin says, Amma, let's get down here. And then we get down there and we explore that place. We map the locality. We find out if there's a park close by. We use Google Maps. I've been trying to get him to go geocaching lately, but that was one of my goals for 2020. Never happened anyway. And we go to the houses in that area or the whatever we can find in the area, talk about it, spark conversations, play I Spy on the bus going forward and coming, play word games. A large amount of Kavin's vocabulary developed just by playing I Spy and just by playing word games, like, you know, find words that rhyme with this, or one word ends here and the next word starts. And what else? I have been doing all this since my daughter was 1 year old. Now she's almost four. I had her in a preschool, but now with COVID, I'm in a dilemma. Your webinar showed the way in the light of personal experience. Thank you for this, Kripa. Thank you so much for having me as well. How do you manage his access to books? Okay, so COVID truly has been hard on all of us. So I decided early on, like in Singapore, from like almost from January, most of Kavin's activities got shut down. Even though schools shut down later, I've been pretty much in almost like 6 months of lockdown right now. So I decided that I would let go of most of the first 2 months, I let go of most of the subjects and I decided only to concentrate on Tamil. So we watched lots of olden day Tamil movies. I made him listen to a lot of Tamil news where the sentences are formed in pure Tamil rather than colloquial Tamil. I did a lot of songs, blah, blah. That was my agenda. So I really couldn't manage. As far as his access of books are concerned, I've already built up this huge library over there. And it'll take him a year to finish reading whatever I have. So that's my plan for now. Of course, we have neighbors. So neighbors lend us books within this apartment complex that we've been living in. I've relied heavily on online resources during COVID. One place that I love to go is mysteryscience.com. Reason being, when you go to mysteryscience.com, they have a lesson plan, and at the end of the lesson plan, they have activities that are inbuilt. So it really gives you a kind of structure. It gives you an age level, and resources are unending on mystery.com. So I really love it. I've put all the links to all these resources that I use in the handout. So that's pretty much it. I think we are done, and I hope I'm on time, Sangeeta.
I think even if you take another half an hour, people would be interested in listening to you. It was such a fun session, so much of knowledge that was shared, and I think people who thought homeschooling was impossible would have got a new ray of hope, right? So the handout part of it, Kripa, if possible, because that asks for access when I try to open it. If you could just put up a post, I'll approve the post. If you could put up all the resources through a post, I think we can make it easily accessible. Yeah.
Mm, sure.
Okay. I think we are done with the questions as well. There are, I think, and since we had the Zoom link put up on the group, I think everybody who wanted to ask questions is here. So thank you so much, Kripa. Precious time. I think, yeah, Divya, would you like to unmute? Yes, Divya, you can unmute yourself if you have any questions for Kripa. I see that your hand is up. Divya, if you're not able to unmute, you can type out your question. Okay. Kripa, very nice of you to spend this time for us. Thank you so much. Very, very nicely explained in proper layman terms. It made it all, look very magical. The whole homeschooling exercise that you said. Thank you so much, Kripa. Very, very nice of you. You're on mute, Kripa.
Mute myself. Okay, fine. Good. Now I'm able to unmute myself. Yeah, thank you so much for bearing with me for 2 hours of non-stop nonsense.
Just one and a half hours. 2 hours, Lala. Just 1.5 hours. It was not nonsense. And I think, so many people have asked me about homeschooling. So you came up with this topic at the right time. So that's really great. Very nice to them.
Yeah, I thank you so much. Really, really thank you so much. It also kind of gave me some clarity to put into, and my ruthless family members today, who two of my mother and my aunt gave a good pre-question FAQ session, which was much more ruthless. Actually, I felt everyone in today was kind of kind with their questions. So it helped me think more about what people would be looking for. Thank you, Mummy and Tata. Thank you for that.
That's what family is for.
That is lovely. I'm sorry, this is supposed to be a 2 hour session.
Yeah, we said 2 to 4.
Oh God, I'm sorry, Sangeeta. I would have gone on longer. For some reason, I thought that it ends at 6 p.m. Singapore time when I looked at my clock, and I kind of rushed through some of the things that I
wanted. Okay. Not an issue. And of course, unless people are passionate about homeschooling, their attention span is also not that great. So the window is 2 to 4. So it depends on, usually a lot of people have a lot of questions. So what we plan is 1 hour of the session and 1 hour of question and answer. So that's how we usually plan. And I think this worked out well. I mean, 90 minutes is very good. It's pretty good. And I didn't think you rushed through. I think you explained pretty clearly. And I don't think anybody had any doubts in as far as the concepts were concerned. And I think, I hope you're able to read through the feedback that you're getting, in the chat box.
Thank you.
A lot of positive feedback that's coming up. So.
Thank you. I'm excited to see what Megha Bharati will do with now her 1-year-old child. I have a hashtag called Raising a Reader Challenge on Instagram, where I've documented the, I had the patience, whatever patience I had to document the books that I've been reading with Kavin since he was 6 months old. Till now, I have like a personal goal target of reading at least 100 new books every year, which initially it was supposed to be a monthly target of 100, but then I realized pretty soon that that's very impractical. So I've changed it to 100 books a year. So if anyone is interested, you can follow that hashtag. It's a mix of all kinds of books that I find at the library. That's one
you
of
could probably type your Insta link in the chat box so that people who want to follow.
This is my Insta link, very simple, Kripa Vimurthy. And I have another hashtag that I just use, which probably Sangeeta knows about, where I document my daily conversations with Kavin. And I call it Hanging Out with Kavin. And if you're interested, email me at kripavimurthy.com, I'm sorry, at gmail.com. And I will share my annual report that I have with Kavin. So if you're really thinking of pursuing homeschooling, then you might have an idea of, you know, I've documented every kind of our day-to-day activities, what we do, what we cover in a year, what we have covered in a year, and what milestones that you can check. And I will email it to you personally. So.
Super, that would be great. Super. So I hope all of you have taken note of her Insta hashtags, her Insta handle, and her email ID. Kripa, I'll be stopping the live stream now. We're done. And I'll be stopping the recording as well. Thank you so much, Kripa. Very